The 2020 Unidos US Annual Conference continues with Session 7. Adelante, Progressive Power in the 2020 Elections. Session 7 is proudly sponsored by JP Morgan Chase & Company and Shell Oil Company. Representing Shell Oil Company is the Production Systems Team Lead for Shell Deepwater, Jacqueline Morales.
Welcome to Unidos Annual Conference and Virtual Marketplace. I'm Jacqueline Morales with Shell Oil. As a native from Mexico and a proud US citizen who voted for the first time in the 2016 elections, I take voting as a responsibility and a privilege that I advocate for with my friends, colleagues, and with the rest of my community. Being Latino also emphasizes the responsibility to participate, collaborate, and partner to inspire younger generations to embrace our right and protect our democracy. As a mother of two young children, that responsibility just increases. Today, the ideas you generate in this forum and the follow-up actions you take after the conference will contribute to making a difference in the upcoming elections. Please embrace this opportunity to voice your thoughts and learn from others. Enjoy the conversation.
Before we begin our panel discussion, we encourage everyone to engage throughout today's program by using the chat, poll, and files function to the right of the screen. And now, the moderator for the session's panel discussion is Latinx advocate, Paola Ramos.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today at the 2020 Unidos US Annual Conference. My name is Paola Ramos. I am a host and correspondent for Vice. I'm also a contributor for Telemundo and MSNBC. And today I have the incredible honor of moderating a very exciting conversation. Everyone knows that there's less than 100 days until the election. And so this session is truly about understanding exactly what's at stake for Latinos in this election and really trying to figure out the strategies that we all have to think about when it comes to mobilizing, when it comes to registering folks, more than anything, when it comes to understanding what we can do to get people to the ballot box in November, particularly given everything that's going in the country right now. So I'm joined by a very powerful group of people, incredible leaders and advocates. We have obviously Congressman Ruben Gallego, who represents Arizona's 7th district, which includes Phoenix. I was actually just there all of last week, Congressman, so we'll get into that. We have Eliazar Posada, who's the Director of Community and Advocacy at Unidos US's affiliate El Centro Hispano in North Carolina. We also have Angelica Razo, the Texas Director for Mi Familia Vota in Houston, which she joined Mi Familia Vota in 2017. Obviously, Texas has seen a lot of growth since. And we, of course, have Clarissa Martinez, the Deputy Vice President of Policy and Advocacy at Unidos US. And I think before we start, I actually want to start with you, Clarissa, just to give us an overview of where the Latino vote stands right now, paint us a picture of what you're seeing, and I think that will help us then dive into the conversation.
Thank you, Paola, and thanks, everybody. It's so exciting to be able to reach so many in our community at this first virtual conference of Unidos US. And I am really excited about the election. I think that every election cycle, we hear contradictory stories about the Latino vote. And so that's why it's always good to start with the numbers. First and foremost, Latinos are going to be the second largest voting community in the electorate in 2020. Number two, registered Latinos vote. There's always a lot of questions about whether Latinos are going to vote or not. When Latinos are registered, 80 to 83% of them consistently vote in presidential elections, which is why it's so important that we continue to work like hell to close that registration gap. And then the other thing is that Latinos are going to play a decisive role, not only because they are concentrated in battleground states or competitive states, and also not just at the presidential, but at the Senate, at the House level, and in down ballot races. So we have one of the fastest growing electorates in the country. Yes, we have to continue working hard to close those registration rates, those registration levels, but we know our community is going to show up, particularly if this year we make sure that states and localities are taking the proper measures to ensure that voters can participate safely And we know that it is possible to make sure that voters are healthy and our democracy is healthy. At the same time, this conversation is so timely because registration being so critical, we know that the coronavirus pandemic has impacted voter registration efforts. So I'm so excited to join the conversation and talk about all the work we're doing to make sure that that registration continues and that we also make sure our community has information about the voting options available to themselves so they can vote healthy in this November.
Of course, and I think that's it, no? We know that Latinos are about to become the largest minority voting bloc, but the reality also is that there are still 11 million eligible Latino voters who are not registered, right? And so that's the question in front of us today. How can we ensure that those folks get registered and act, no? How can we ensure that first-time voters, young voters are inspired even amidst the incredible pain and loss that surround us, no? How can we ensure that people can actually access the ballot box? And how can we ensure that all of this incredible movement for justice actually manifests in real change? No, so that's what today is about. And Congressman Gallego, I'm gonna start with you. As I had mentioned, I just spent 10 days in Maricopa County. I wish I could say that it wasn't crazy, but it was absolutely crazy to be there during the pandemic. One of the things that I noticed obviously is how just in one county, you can have completely different responses to the virus, no? It's completely politicized. There's, on the one hand, there's folks that don't see anything. On the other hand, there's folks that are feeling the pain and the loss. And so my question to you is, how do you think the pandemic is actually going to affect the Latino vote? Now, will this mobilize people? Will this make us stay at home? Like, how are you seeing this pandemic influencing our vote?
Well, I think what it is going to really have an influence on is the understanding of what government can and can't do for you. And the inequality that we saw in Arizona in terms of the Latino community, it's just so stark. I live in South Phoenix, a majority Latino area. Access to testing was nearly impossible. Mm-hmm. I had people that were waiting in their cars in Arizona right now. It's about 115 degrees, by the way. Waiting in cars 8 to 10 hours just so they get a test. And then they're not even getting the test back in time for it to even be useful. The highest rates of COVID-19 infection are in the Latino families. Even though we only make 30% of the population, we're nearly 50% of those that are being infected. And why is that? Well, two reasons. Number one, we have a lot of health disparities that we already start out with. You know, we have less people on health insurance. We have, you know, high rates of asthma, all these things that are just were pre-existent prior to COVID-19. The other thing is that we are the workers of Arizona. Literally, we were the people that kept Arizona fed. Kept people in their homes, cleaned up in the hospitals, pulled the food out. So while everyone was quarantining for 2 months, the people that were still stocking our shelves, that were still, you know, working out there as essential workers every day, were Latinos. Mm-hmm. And then because we live in multi-generational households, right, you know, a lot of these working families brought back the virus, unfortunately, to their homes and then spreading out. And to make matters worse, this governor and the legislature reopened too soon. And so they opened up the economy too soon because they wanted to, you know, quote unquote, get the economy kickstarted. Well, again, what happened there was they reopened without any mask mandate, without any suggestions of social distancing. And it was the Latino worker that was going and still serving at our restaurants, at our bars, being employed, that was exposed to this. And then they further get, you know, penalized by not having access to insurance. Some of them being undocumented are even afraid to go ask for help. And many of them just feel, and you hear about the despair when you watch TV, they feel that they've been abandoned. So what does that mean? I think that this election, unlike many elections that have happened in the past in Arizona, it's all about healthcare, COVID-19, and how the Latino community feels they've been treated during COVID-19. Yeah. The one benefit about Arizona is that we actually have a traditional vote by mail system that we've worked on for now close to 30 years as a state. But as activists and those aligned with the Latino community, we've been working to get Latinos on vote by mail for the last 10 years. And we've actually had a lot.
Yeah, because I think that's the biggest question in front of us. Speaking of given what you just described, which I feel like is a reality, not just in your state, but in pretty much all the states across the country, like what you just described is what we're up against, no?
Yeah.
And so we'll talk about the different strategies, but I think given that, no? And Clarissa, when you think of the 11 million folks that are not registered to vote, who are they? No, like what's the breakdown and what do you think is keeping them from being registered right now? No,
there's a variety of things. I mean, one thing that is true is that Latinos as a community, we are a young community, mm-hmm. and we also have high mm-hmm. mobility rates. So we have a lot of the indicators that for any group in the electorate tend to shape lower levels of participation. But here's the thing, a part of it is also that many of us may be the first voter in our families and a first-time voter, which means that we're not familiar with the processes, or when we turn 18, that's not necessarily something that is top of mind. And that's one of the reasons why we are, at the same time, we're seeing this electorate grow at a faster pace than others, mm-hmm. because we have almost a million 18-year-olds every year that become eligible to register, who are Latino citizens turning 18. We also have the big pool that you reference, 11 million folks who are in need of registration and need those conversations that are so important to bring people into the process. And then we have more than 5 million immigrants who are eligible for citizenship in the Latino community. Those things are going to continue to shape our growth. In the meantime, it is that outreach, both from community organizations like the ones in this panel, but also the outreach that is needed from candidates and campaigns to really touch and energize and inspire these voters to actually come out and support them.
Mm-hmm. You talk about outreach. So Eliazar and Angelica, what does it mean to be on the ground right now? No? I mean, I feel like you've been doing this for a long time, but your jobs are probably nothing like what they've been in the past. So what does it mean to register folks right now? Now, what are some of the unique strategies and tactics that you're using to register folks? And what are some of the nuances that you have to navigate right now?
Yeah, if we could just zoom out of Arizona and just bring, so I can bring y'all into Texas, which is, we know, is not a very voter-friendly state, particularly for people of color, for minority communities. It's been hard, and our jobs have looked completely different. As Clarissa was talking about the young vote, and keeping in mind that Texas is a very young state, that's those who are under the age of 30, 70% of them are people of color. Like, that's what our future looks like, right? And we have a voting system, an election system that has historically barred these folks from participating. So for us to not be able to do our voter registration programs in schools because folks are not convening in classes because it's so much safer not to, right? We've lost a huge pool of people who would have entered that electorate in 2020. Mm-hmm. We're looking forward to voting in the presidential election. Mm-hmm. As Representative Gallego was talking about our essential workers, we have 18-year-olds and 19-year-olds and 20-year-olds who have just aged into voting that are essential workers that are at the front lines of Texas during this pandemic and providing for our families. And we haven't created systems that are friendly to them so we can say, hey, as you're providing for us and getting us through this pandemic, please vote on your behalf. Please have all these resources at your hand. So I think we need to recognize the energy that our young folks are providing us right now and the protection and make sure we're doing creative strategies to reach them and make sure they have all the information and all the resources so they feel empowered to say, man, I'm contributing a lot right now to my country, to my nation, to my democracy. And I want to feel supported as I do become a first-time voter. So let's not just put everything on them, right? Let's make sure our strategy as civic groups and government entities that we're really supporting them through this process, especially right now.
Yeah. What about in North Carolina? Yeah, what is it looking like there?
Yeah, so like in a lot of other states and, you know, across the country, we had a plan of, you know, really diving deep into community, going into schools, going into businesses, going into neighborhoods, and really knocking on doors and getting some of our Latinx folks registered, and then doing some work to get them to the voting polls. that looks a little different, right? So we want to protect not just ourselves, but also our community from COVID. So we've had to take a different approach, right? So, and I'm very thankful for the partnership with Unidos US because we have an online way of being able to register people to vote through the LEAP program. Of course, North Carolina is one of the states that doesn't allow for online registration. They've made some changes in the last months where if you have a driver's license, you can update your registration or you can register online, but the process is just complicated and convoluted and just not friendly to folks. So I'm very thankful for that LEAP link that we're able to push out. But it's really galvanizing our youth, specifically since North Carolina has a lot of really young voters who are now becoming a voting age. And they're like Larissa said, you know, I've never voted before. My family hasn't voted in the US before because we're immigrants. You know, many times parents are undocumented. So we're launching like the message of, we're not gonna tell you who to vote for because we can't.
Right.
But we can tell you for whom you should be voting for, right? You should be thinking of your family, of your communities, of the resources that you need when you go to that voting booth, not just then, right? But before you go on there, when you're getting educated, when you're talking to community leaders with politicians, with candidates, that's kind of our message right now. You know, vote. If your parents can't, then you should.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything that's surprising you guys right now, just from what you're seeing? Are the trends similar from, say, what you were seeing in 2016 or in the midterms? Or is there anything on the ground that's unique about this moment?
People are ready. I know a lot of young people, some that are not even eligible to vote in this election, they're gonna, alongside me, Familia Vota, and all the other groups that are working on this, they're gonna find a way to get their families and friends registered to vote. Mm-hmm. Previous election years, we would we still continue to do our trainings virtually, but they would actually co-facilitate voter education and voter registration drives, even if they were not eligible to vote, whether they were underage or undocumented. Mm-hmm. The energy has persisted, and I think it says a lot about the emotional, you know, times we're living in, that people say, I feel like I need to do something and work together. Let's think creatively. Let's think strategically. So online platforms, calling each other, sending forms out, like they are becoming voting experts, which does a lot because, again, our systems are not very friendly. And so they're trying to gather all that information and then be the own messenger in their own community pocket.
Right.
So I would say very similar to 2018. There's a lot of energy on the ground, and we have to make sure we're able to meet it.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
No, yeah. So I was going to mention, like, we've also seen that from our youth, right? We're living in with not just COVID-19, but everything that are being addressed every day around police brutality and, Black lives. We're starting to see the youth not only galvanizing the streets and protesting when they can, but also, like, finding out, like, what can I do right now, right? What can I do to not just, you know, be present and be supportive of our, you know, Black brothers and sisters and siblings, but how can we move forward to, like, be there for our community as well? So we've been trying to work with our youth to really use that momentum that really exists right now and getting engaged in different levels of government to also add that portion of, you know, it's important to be present. It's important to manifest your desires and your asks and your demands. But at the same time, you also have the responsibility for yourself, for your community, for your family, to register yourself, register whoever you can, and make sure that you go out and vote. So we've done our best to tie that registration into everything going on. But compared to last time we did it, youth are really the ones driving a lot of that engagement this
Yeah.
time.
And talking about youth, I mean, Congressman, when I was in your district, every day I saw young Latinos marching for BLM. Like every day I would step out of the door, and at 5 p.m. they were out there. They were in downtown Phoenix protesting. And so when I think of, you know, I've worked in two presidential campaigns, and when I think of some of the previous outreach that we used to do, it was, you want to win Latinos, talk about immigration. Again, it's incredibly important, but I guess from this conversation, What do you, Congressman, what does everyone see as the top issue or some of the top issues that are driving young people to be inspired to register? Is it immigration only, or are we sort of expanding this notion of the issues that are driving us to want to be involved?
I think we have to think about immigration as the gatekeeper issue. Mm-hmm. You first have to be good on immigration issues in order for young Latinos or Latinos in general to even give you the opportunity to engage them.
Yeah.
This year, I feel, you know, and I when I was protesting out there with for BLM and for racial justice, it was very inspiring. You know, Arizona does not have a huge Black population. You know, as a matter of fact, if I think my district probably has the most in the state, and we're probably only looking at about 8% of my district is actually African American. But the organizers, when I was out there protesting, were young Latinos and Latinas, actually mostly Latinas. And they were, you know, so passionate about racial justice, and they were, you know, you could tell that they understood what the true crime that was happening in our community, especially when it comes to the status of Black men being disproportionately killed by our police force. And I think that is driving a lot of the activism that you see right now among young Latinos. What's happening with COVID-19, exposing this kind of inequality that's occurring. And lastly, in Arizona, especially climate change. Because we disproportionately live in areas that unfortunately get affected by climate change, these young Latinos understand that, they see it, and they vote for it. They ask you about it. You know, it's one of their top priorities. And you have to remember, when it's 115 degrees in Arizona, the only way you can, you know, do anything about this, you have to cool yourself. Well, if you're poor, you're not going to be able to upgrade your air conditioning. You're not going to be able to, you know, get better insulation. So those are the big drivers that are really happening. I mean, they're always going to care about immigration, especially when it comes to DACA, because they don't want to see their friends deported. But these other issues are definitely driving have a very strong sense of passion within the community right now.
Clarissa, does that reflect what you're seeing in the research that Unidos is doing in terms of the top issues that are driving us? And I mention this just because, again, I think this is like such a unique time where we're all sort of like breaking these stereotypes, and that is being reflected in campaigns finally. But is mm-hmm. that what Unidos is seeing?
Well, the thing about how Latinos react to immigration has been one of the biggest misunderstandings, misconceptions, or bad advice that campaigns have gotten for a long time. And I agree with the congressman that a lot of times when candidates would think about Latinos, if they did at all, it would be to talk about immigration. And he is right. Mm-hmm. And that's what connects it to this moment. So right now, unsurprisingly, historically, the economy and jobs and healthcare and education have been in the top three for Latinos. So unsurprisingly, given what we've talked about, the disproportionate impact on the community health and economic wise of the pandemic, COVID response and healthcare costs have skyrocketed to the top of the agenda by a lot. Next to that, also unsurprisingly, jobs, wages, unemployment, very important. But even in the midst of that health pandemic, it is notable to see that in the number three spot, you see racial justice, concerns about immigration, about discrimination in the treatment of immigrants. And that has a direct connection to the Latino connection to the current moment of racial justice. Because whether or not we are immigrants, and there are Latinos who've been American citizens since the birth of the nation, is that we see the way that politicians talk about immigrants and the way they deal with the immigration issue as a proxy for how they regard the whole of the Latino community, regardless of immigration status. So that's why it is indeed a gateway issue, is a weather vane, but right now also concern about COVID and about jobs, because they're existential, are driving this. And one mm-hmm. of the important things is to see that activism that we're seeing reflected in the streets, that for our community is so important to make sure that our voices are being heard in las calles, en el Congreso, y también en las casillas.
The other side of it is that even with all the activism and even with all of this incredible work, and even as folks are inspired, and Angelica, you already mentioned this, we're still facing deep structural issues, particularly when it comes to actually accessing the ballot box. Now, obviously, that's everyone in this panel knows that. And particularly today, those civil rights are under threat. No, that's front and center. So I just want to talk about that step of actually, like, what will it take for our vote to actually count? No, and especially considering everything that we're up against. And Congressman, I mean, again, you're in a battleground state where Trump won by less than 4% in 2016. I mean, Republicans, yeah, we know, have gone above and beyond to trying to do everything that they can in their power to suppress that vote. So what do you see as the main barriers Latinos will be facing, or your constituents will be facing, when it comes to actually voting?
Right. So I think the main barrier is that since we don't have active voter registration drive in the traditional sense, which we do a lot of voter registration in Arizona as nonprofits and C4s, especially targeted Latino community. The problem that we're going to have is for those young Latinos that aren't registered to vote or are registered to vote but have not signed up for vote by mail, we fear that they may end up not voting. We have a very progressive county recorder, Adrian Fuentes, who is trying to make sure that everyone has access to the ballot. He's opening up 100 early voting sites. And we want to obviously push everyone to vote by mail. But because of the time that we're dealing with right now, not necessarily active suppression, but just because of COVID-19 social distancing, it's harder for us to actually make that person-to-person contact, which is what we rely on. Usually every cycle by now, I've already hit about 10,000 doors in my own district, right? Now I can't do that, so I'm trying to do everything digitally. Mm-hmm. And so it worries me because in 2018, the largest group that showed up on election day were young Latinos at the polling places, which is great. It means they were excited. They knew that their vote counted, and they had the last minute push, and they went and did it. We don't want to see that now. We want them to vote early. We want them to go to an early voting site. We don't want the potential of COVID-19 to diminish their opportunity to participate. So that's what we're worried about. In terms of actual suppression, the state government is fairly good about this issue because the county recorders largely run their programs, and we just have a history of early voting that it'd be really hard for them to get rid of. If there's any active suppression that could happen, I think unfortunately maybe more along, maybe police officers, not police officers, but generally like federal police kind of showing up to interfere and intimidate people. That might be the one area they could try to do that. But other than that, at least in Arizona, it's going to be tougher. And also, unfortunately, we're kind of used to intimidation also.
Right. No, but I the point is that it's all about educating folks. And the truth
absolutely.
Is that a lot of people, there is a lot of confusion, right? We keep hearing
from
many folks. Yep. People are scared also, obviously, of the virus. And honestly, like, people don't even know where to look, know where to find this information. So I want to open it up to the group. How do we best educate our community in terms of the best and the safest ways to vote right now? No? What are the tactics that we should be thinking about when it comes to delivering that message to them? Because the congressman mentioned voting by mail. A lot of people don't even know that that's an option, particularly when the president of the United States doesn't want that to be an option. How do we make sure that people know?
So I think many of us, and we'll hear from Eliezer and Angie, but many of us are working on, the most robust public awareness and an education campaign for voters that we have ever been able to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, at Unidos, in our voter registration programs, just like our colleagues, we had to figure out how to safeguard that important person-to-person contact that really brings folks who have not been part of the process into the process, mm-hmm, and translate it to virtual, right? So not in person, but maintaining that person-to-person contact. And that's the way we're moving forward, trying to do contact with households, trying to register people to offer information about vote by mail, and about early day voting. And all of those things are going to be so key that depending on how well we do, and also how well campaigns do at energizing voters, this year we could see the Latino vote reach to 15 million voters.
Wow. Well, one thing that we're working here in North Carolina, because the state does have a history of trying to suppress people of color, right? We had a pretty public a fight in the courts not too long ago where it was the law that was created by North Carolina legislator was struck down because it surgically targeted people of color to be suppressed, right? With the voter ID laws, with the changing in early voting and all the other things that they were trying to do here in the state. But so one of the things that we've been working with is not just, you know, letting folks know there is still a early voting period where a lot of local boards of elections are doing the best they can to ensure that social distancing is possible. They're hiring people to be able to clean as much as possible and making it as safe for folks who want to in-person vote. And we're advocating on the other side to expanding those dates, right? So instead of just, you know, four or five places in a county, let's have more days. And not only have people from the community act as poll workers, but bring in some from other counties where you have a lot of folks who want to be poll workers who don't have the space in their counties, which was up to a couple of weeks ago, something that North Carolina didn't authorize, right? So we have a lot of folks in Orange County want to be involved in helping get people out to the voting polls and help them out when they're there, but they couldn't take those people from Orange to Durham, which is a neighboring county, which in Durham needed more help, right? So we're advocating so that the places have the resources they need, as well as this really robust campaign, as Clarissa said, of, you know, still trying to keep that person-to-person contact. We've never, as an organization, had a huge, like, phone banking aspect to us. It's always been in person. ¿Cómo está? Vamos con la comadre. We go talk to the people, right? And we just, like, do that really person to person, right? Because that's where our community is. That's our culture, right? You know, el cafecito en la tarde, like talking to folks, that's our culture. So we have been working with some of our community leaders to create like little videos to share with folks, because we've also in our website and in our social media put out like a commonly asked questions, right? There is mail-in voting, there is early voting. This is how you get those forms. This is how that works. But at the same time, we know some folks don't have the time to go into websites and read long articles. So like 1 minute videos, the information they need, let's put it out. We're sending it out and we're making sure that folks are receiving the information from all areas, not just, you know, from us, but we've been trying to work with our media partners here in the state to like push that.
And I would assume because so much of this has now shifted to digital that young Latinos are probably
Yes. Into
a role that is unprecedented, no? I mean, it sounds
yep.
Yeah. Are you actually in that program right now, which is great.
Yeah, go ahead.
And I think having more young people present in this space with us and leading efforts has also been great, because people who would have previously said, oh, like, I'm a tech person, like, politics aren't for me, they're finding a great role in this. Our creative minds, our artists, they're really thriving right now. So I'm excited. As we're, like Clarissa and Elizar was saying, we have to be super creative and, you know, find all the different channels. We're actually able to bring in a lot of new folks who said, I don't know if this was the space for me beforehand, but they're the ones leading these efforts. Mm-hmm. People with all different skills and interests are the ones that are really driving this forward. And then I did want to touch really quickly on early voting versus election day.
Yep.
I always hear this narrative of, well, long lines wouldn't be a thing if people just voted early, right? But as a person who will phone bank till 7 p.m. on election day, I am getting people to the polls at 6:58, you know, stand in lines. So I think we do have to challenge our local county offices to say, like, we need to expect that surge and we need to welcome it and be prepared to deal with it, as opposed to getting frustrated and then putting the blame on people who decided to come very last minute to the polls.
Right. Those are so true.
And that was actually my next question, like, what is the game day plan, right? Like, knowing that this is to be expected, knowing that we're already at a disadvantage given the amount of people that don't want us to vote, that want us to wait in line longer. What's the game plan on election day to ensure that
we're expected? Yeah, so in 2018, we actually did anticipate this surge at the polls just because we felt the energy was going the right way. And then particularly in Maricopa County. So what we did on election day, we had, poll watchers at every poll. They were there to make sure, especially the ones where there were heavy Latino presence, we informed them of their rights to make sure they knew that they had the right to stay in line. As it was getting longer and longer, because people were going to stick it out. We brought water, we brought pizza, we brought juices, and then we just kept on phone banking throughout the whole day, all, you know, just telling people where they could go and vote, what the rights are to vote. We had lines, sorry, not lines, we had taxis going picking up people to go and vote. So it was a very strategic initiative, I think, that really, really mattered. And I was at one polling place until 8:30, you know, to make sure, and the polls closed at 7 in Arizona, because there was one family that was just waiting in line, and I was going to make sure that we make it all the way through with them. And it was very inspiring. They, you know, they had just gotten off work. They got their family. They all came together as fast as they could. You're going to see that again. And I think we're going to have to both support them emotionally, but we're going to support them as whatever way else we can. Bring chairs for them, bring water, bring masks. If we're still in the time of COVID, I think it's going to be really important.
Yeah. Does anyone else have anything to add about that?
So one thing that we're trying to get folks to do is prepare in case you can't go in, right, to in person, right? We know a lot of our community members have high risk or have different risk factors when it comes to COVID-19. And in North Carolina, although we make less than 10% of the population of the state, we make up for over about 40% of the new cases. Right. So that's astronomical. So what we're trying to do is let folks know, you know, if you feel like you can't go there in person, that does not mean that you need to give away you can still vote. Right. And that's the mail-in ballots. And what we're pushing now is go ahead and send in the form to get your mail-in ballot now. And if you don't use it, you go in person, that's fine. But at least have that, you know, that ability for you. Right. Because it comes down to a couple of weeks before the election and COVID is still an issue, and you have family at home, you have people with high risk, you're not going to want to put yourself or your family at risk. And I understand that. And we, you know, want to, we know that, and we want to support you in that. But that means that you can't at that point order your mail-in ballot, right? It's a little too late. So, you know, to not get to that point, we're sending out forms now. We're talking to folks about, like, when we have these conversations, but are you registered? Well, yeah, I am. Cool. Did you already order your mail-in ballot? No, boys, yep. I don't want to do that. Great. Here's the instructions. You know, do you need me to send you the form? I can, we actually stole an idea from Unidos US, and I've been sending people the form with already a prepaid envelope so that they can send it out to their.
That's smart.
You didn't steal it, and yes, that is open source.
Oh, there you go. Well, that's good. This is good for people to know all the options. Yeah.
I mean, it's very intentional on putting resources in where people need, right? We always talk about let's meet people where they're at. In this case, we can't meet them physically, but we can definitely use the mail system to get all the forms they need and all the resources they need to make sure that we are, our voices heard in November.
Yeah.
We are constantly in Arizona just pinging everybody, anybody that registers that we think will, you know, obviously we're in a nonpartisan, but we think will vote in a manner that we think will help the Latino community. As soon as we see them register to vote, they are receiving a vote by mail application. And to make things better, one of the things that we have in Arizona that if we can adopt in every other state would be a huge difference. We actually have what's called a permanent early voter list. So there are a lot of people that don't request their ballot every year. They just get automatically a ballot for every election. So I actually haven't requested a ballot now in 15 years because I've been on the permanent early voter list for 15 years. And once we get a Latino on the permanent early voter list, the chance of them voting in a election, in a presidential election is nearly 80%, which is a great number for Arizona considering that we are younger and we are more mobile.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the great things about how many of us are coming together is that in addition to the advocacy work that has to continue to make sure that there are stronger voting processes, like what the congressman was describing in Arizona, that actually support the voter, right? And what the voter needs. I think what has become more clear than ever, this is true in every election, but particularly in this one, is that preparation and planning equals participation, right? Mm-hmm. So the work that Eliezer was talking about and that we're doing together, and that Mi Familia, what they're doing in Texas, is like, let's make sure people have the information and the tools in a timely way to take action and get registered, to get registered to vote by mail, that if they prefer to go vote early, that they have that information, right? So the preparation, the planning, we're also engaged in the conversations with voters, making a pledge to vote and making a plan, what steps will they take? Because then that starts making it more real. And then the reminders that people need to make sure that they don't miss those important deadlines. So I think on the side of civic groups like ours, that preparation, planning, equal participation. Mm-hmm. And I think that where the campaigns and candidates are involved, they need to remember that candidates matter, their positions matter, and the meaningful yep. outreach they need to do with the community is essential.
Right. Yeah, and go ahead.
Just to add to that, I think it's also bringing different states together. Yeah. I think in Texas, we were really guilty of just accepting our election system and the way we did voter registration. And when this pandemic hit and we were scrambling, okay, what can we change immediately? What can we change in the long term? I saw a lot of perspectives from different states coming together, particularly from the Latino community, saying like, this has worked really well in Arizona. This has worked well in California. You know, when this initiative was passed, we struggled and these were the challenges for our communities, and this is how we've learned from it. So I think I'm really excited, you know, beyond 2020, how national conversation about what are the systems at large we need to have in place, mm-hmm. as opposed to, you know, accepting, you know, the fact that in Texas we don't have online voter registration. Vote by mail has still not been expanded.
So crazy.
What can we learn from Arizona? What can we learn from North Carolina? And I think I just love different Latinos coming together and just sharing ideas and information and resources with one another.
I will say, and I think for any activist or any organization that is trying to do vote by mail and engage in Latino community, please do reach out to us in Arizona. We have now more than a decade of experience doing this. And we have, you know, trained organizations that will spread the gospel. And we have just years of anecdotal history and data on how to do this. I know it's going so well in terms of Latinos voting by mail, because every year, the last two years, the legislature has tried to change the law to make it more difficult for people to sign up for vote by mail. And that was never a partisan issue in the past, because vote by mail was predominantly used by the Anglo community. In the last 2 years, the tables have turned and Latinos have caught up, and now they want to restrict it more. So it must mean we're doing something right. And we would love to kind of spread our knowledge when it comes to this. And, you know, all the works that require it, because it is a multi-step process. You need to ask them to sign it up, need to make sure they actually sign up, make sure they have to return it, and then you actually have to follow up with them, call them when they get their ballot, and then make sure they actually return the ballot. So it's request the ballot, and then you have to do this chase after that. And it takes a lot of legwork, and people, if you want to do it right, you have to fully commit to it. You can't just say, have something just sign up and just be done with it.
Yeah. Just thinking about the next 90 days before the election, given that you're all on the ground. It's not 98? Well, no.
Early voting starts in many places 30 days beforehand. So again, you got to retrain yourself. In Arizona, early voting starts in October.
That's exactly right. No, we have to reach it. You're 100% right. So given that we're almost around the corner, if you were in a room with Vice President Joe Biden right now, and you are giving him one piece of advice, you know, what is the one thing Biden's campaign needs to keep in mind when it comes to the Latino vote in the next 100 days?
So I would say this to any campaign: if you want our people to come out on the voting polls, put the effort in getting to know our Latinx families and advocates and our community, right? You can't just expect, oh, I'm gonna put out a commercial or someone that I know who's popular in the Latinx community and it's gonna be in Spanish and bam, I'm gonna get their support. It's not gonna happen like that. You need to put some effort into it. Just like as much effort you're putting into donors, put into the Latino voters.
Mm-hmm. I would say don't assume that you already have all the solutions.
Yep.
Our human experiences, our community experiences, particularly during the pandemic, I think our community really knows some really great initiatives and policies that need to be put forward. So listen, as you're listening to people's stories, let those be the pathway to some great policy solutions, and keep those in mind beyond November, because we're watching not just for November, but beyond that. So we're not just turning out for November and turning out for one election every 4 years. We're very much present. And so keep that in mind.
Mm-hmm. And if anyone else wants to say anything, please
do. I'll repeat, you know, we have this mantra that we provide this advice to any candidate listening, right? The candidate matters. They need to build a relationship with this community. Their positions matter. Make your record known. Where do you stand on the issues that this community cares about? And meaningful outreach is essential. Don't take us for granted, right? I mean, and that's like Eleazar said, this is not rocket science. This tends to be the playbook they use with voters they care about. But often with Latinos, it seems that the outreach is really lackluster. We have seen that even with highly engaged Latino voters, they don't get outreach. But then if they don't get energized and come out, they get blamed by people who lose. And what I would say is that do those things, and then don't forget that, yes, people are angry and they're concerned. We are in the middle of a crisis, and it is also important to communicate what you're for. Don't just expect people to vote for you because what they are against. You also need to give them a reason of what to be for.
Mm-hmm. And lastly, I guess, because I am sometimes in the room.
No, I know.
So I feel like this is kind of a layup for me. What I've told them is you need to lead with passion, and you need to make the investment. And if you do those two, then you get the return on investment. Mm. And maybe I see it a little too, maybe I'm too much in the room, but at least in Arizona, we're seeing that. And, you know, we're so excited because like this is the first time any of us have seen Arizona as a swing state, right? And we see our commercials on Univision, we see the digital ads, we see everything. So I know at least they're doing it in Arizona. But it does matter other places. You know, we could be the difference in Michigan, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, definitely North Carolina and Florida. You know, these states might come down to just a couple thousand. And if you can motivate, you know, those communities, it matters. And then lastly, I always say this, you know, we're not a monolith. You know, I'm Colombiano Mexicano, right? And born in the United States, but, you know, mostly raised by my Colombian side of my family, though I lived in Chihuahua, Mexico for a couple years, but I live in Arizona, right? So they need to make sure they actually understand our community, and we're not one, you know, monolith. You know, we all don't watch Univision and listen to Norteñas, or watch Telemundo and listen to Pachata, right? There's so many ways to be able to do this. But make sure you're using multiple levels of communication. Treat us like a sophisticated community that we are, and I think you'll have better results in terms of communication.
Mm-hmm. We have just a couple of minutes, so I just want to end with a clear message. Now, every election we say, what's that say for Latinos? And I feel like it comes here and it goes out. But just in your own words, just short, A, what's that say for us? And but then B, what do you think when we wake up on November 3rd? And I always think about that. I remember every election, what the headline is. Like, what do you think the headline will be in terms of the Latino vote that morning? Or I guess November 4th. Like, what will the story be based on what you're seeing about the Latino vote in this election? So take whichever question you want and we get in like that.
I mean, I'll just dive right in. Our livelihood, you know, our quality of life, what our daily life looks like every single day, whether we're going to work, you know, at school, you know, whatever environment we live in, our livelihood is really at stake. Mm-hmm. And the headline I think is Latinos turned each other out. Like, let's take ownership of that. Like, we are the ones on the ground. We're the ones that are having the conversations in Ingles y Español. And WhatsApp, and we're the ones that are turning each other out despite the pandemic, despite the, you know, lack of access to democracy. And we should celebrate that regardless of what the outcome on November 3rd is. Yes. The hard work, and we put it in. And again, let's celebrate that. Let's embrace our narrative around that.
Mm-hmm. I feel like every election we hear, this is the most election.
100%, which is why I'm asking.
But, you know, for the first time, I'm actually feeling that this is an extremely, if not the most important election, right? Not just talking about our economy, not just talking about the health system, not just talking about COVID or DACA or all these other policies that are affecting all of our people in the day-to-day lives in, not just in Arizona and Texas and North Carolina, but across the United States, right? So that's for us, that's what we're trying to tell people. You know, we always say this, we always say it's the most important election, but this time we mean it. Like, la verdad, this is, you know, there's a lot of issues for you to be engaged on. There's a lot of community members that are depending on each and every one of us to make our voice heard. And I do agree. I want the headline to be Latinos killed it, because we got our people out to vote. That's what I want to see.
So I think the what's at stake is really democracy. And this is literally one of the most largest threats, I think, to American democracy we've had since the Civil War. I do not trust that we can survive as a nation for another 4 years and still call ourselves a democracy. And the ramifications that will happen in the next 4 years will end up affecting our community for I don't even know how long. I mean, just look at yesterday that he's trying to do an executive order to exclude Latinos or undocumented people from the census, right? He's doing that because, you know, the future is brown. And if you have to, if you start creating congressional districts, legislative districts, they're going to reflect the country, which is not what they want. But right now, we are in such a dire strait that we potentially could be throwing away by ballot box a democracy. And the only people that might stand in the way of that are a couple thousand young Latinos in Arizona, a couple thousand young Latinos in Florida, in North Carolina, and Pennsylvania. We might be the ultimate defenders of democracy that this country will go back and look someday. So what I think is going to happen when we read the headlines, I think it's going to say, number one, ballots still being counted, because that's going to happen. But number two, you know, surge in last minute Latino voters gives hope to the country. Mm. And I think that's will be something I think we all be proud of.
Yeah, I think to me it's clear that for anybody who cares about better housing, about better schools, better jobs, an immigration policy we can be proud of, the growth of the Latino electorate should be a welcome development, because that's what these voters care about. And so for me, the headline in some ways mirrors a headline now. Mm-hmm. We know that Latinos are essential workers that are helping the rest of us survive this pandemic. And I want to see a headline that Latinos are part of those essential voters that produced results the country can be proud of. And just like Latinos after every disaster, we're going to be there to help rebuild and to help recover, because that's what our community knows, and it's resilient. So I say, let's activate the comadre, the compadre, the padrino, the padrina network, the old phone trees with the new tech tools, and let's make sure that our folks are registered, they have information about their voting options, y que nada nos detenga en las elecciones.
Wow. I have been writing it down, because I truly do want to compare these, what you just said, to what we see. And I want to thank you all so much for being part of this conversation, for what you're doing on the ground, for what you see, for what you defend, for what you do for all of us. So thank you for joining us today. I mean, the congressman said it, no, we may be the ultimate defenders of democracy. And I think that's exactly what the session is about. And that's exactly what this message is about. For everyone that's watching, this session will be available at the end of the day in the schedule section of the conference platform in case you want to watch it again. And remember, you can register to vote by visiting adelanteunidos.com. If this wasn't enough to inspire you and to mobilize you, then I don't know what, but watch this, get inspired. Remember what what all of these incredible folks said, and we will see you in a couple of days out there mobilizing people. So thank you.
Thank you.
Today's program will be available to watch again at the end of the day by clicking the replay button in the menu bar. And starting next week, you can also view the entire conference at conference.com. www.unidosus.org. The 2020 Unidos US Annual Conference continues with Session 8, Phenomenal Latinas, in their own words. But first, we would like to again recognize our sponsors for their generous support. Conference title sponsor, Bank of America. Virtual Marketplace title sponsor, UPS. Session sponsors, PepsiCo, Wells Fargo, State Farm, Comcast NBC Universal Telemundo, The Walton Family Foundation, JP Morgan Chase & Company, and Shell Oil Company. Entertainment session sponsors, Molson Coors and Target. Leading media partners, Charter Communications, Comcast NBC Universal Telemundo, DiversityCom, Hispanicize, Latino 247 Media Group, Latino Leaders Magazine, and Univision. Contributing media partners, Luz Collective, and MeToo.